Hello, I'm Ellie for Edu for Java, and this is tutorial number 3 of Android game programming. In this tutorial, we're going to see the concept of game loop and a bit of animation techniques. What is game loop? Loop is something which repeats itself. What we're going to do in the game loop is mainly two principal activities. One is the so-called physics update, which updates the physics, and the other one would be the drawing. As we said before, a video is made up of a lot of images. Which are similar. And when we see them one after the other one in a high frequency, we think it's a video or an animation inside this loop. We're going to print different screens, and it's going to look as if it were an animation or a film. This would be the drawing inside the game loop. The other important activities would be the update of the physics. As for example, if we have a character in our screen and it walks. It walks, for example, to the right with 1 pixel speed. 10 pixels per second each print. Each new print has to update its position to be able to print it where we want. This will be one of the activities developed in the update. Okay, the update of the score is another of these activities. Imagine, for example, if you are playing a game which takes points of your score as you play. This would also be done here. Okay, let's do our game loop. Our game loop is going to receive in another thread. Let's create a thread for this loop first. For this game loop, so that it's independent. We are going to do this with this class here. We're going to make a class game loop thread, and with this new class, we are going to put it inside this code. Okay, done. It's a bit untidy. Okay, we have a view which we're going to pass as a parameter when we build this object game thread. We're going to build the object in the view, so we're going to pass this as a parameter. It also has a variable running. While it is true, it's going to run the loop. It's going to run one time and another while this variable is true. In the run method, the while is going to repeat until running is true. The way of making this loop stop is to set run to false. Then in the next round it would stop. In this version here of the game loop, we have put the painting of the canvas, the door, here we see we have get the canvas doing the lock. We do a view dot on draw, and lastly we do unlock. We repeat this one time And another. Okay, now what we need is make the declaration of a field in the surface view. Yes. We add a new field. We do the creation. We create the thread object and now we start it. Now instead of calling it in the surface created, we set running to true and directly we call start, and start is going to make the execution in another thread of the method run, and it's going to start going around, and the method undo here is going to be called once and again. I think we are needing the imports. Okay. I didn't save the class. Okay. If everything is okay, this should run now. It's not going to be very interesting because what we're going to see that even if the loop is running once and again, it does it in the same place. So there's really nothing to see. We should try to make this a bit more lively. For this, we're going to create a variable x in the view, which is going to give us the position x for our printing of the icon here. And here we're going to write an X, Shift Control F, tie this up a bit. Okay, let's try. Here we can see, if you watch carefully, you can notice the speed is not constant, it increases and decreases. This is because the loop goes around as quickly as possible. This depends on the CPU given to the process. How much execution time it has, and this time is variable. Because of this, when it has a lot of time, it goes quicker. And when there is more process running at the same time, it goes slower. This is not good. We can solve this limiting how many frames per second we are going to print frames per second. Let's put 10. This means that a maximum of 10 frames are going to be printed. It's going to go around 10 times maximum in a second. If there is time for more, we're going to slow it. And we're going to do this using the instruction sleep. Let's make it sleep as much as the loop. The loop has a certain time to execute itself. If it goes very quickly, we're going to stop it. This is what we're going to do. These are the frames per second in our case, 10. If we divide it by 1000, it would be 1 second, and this is going to result in ticks per PS. The ticks PS are going to give us 100. What does this mean? 100 is the minimum which each loop has to last. Then, at the beginning of the loop, we take the time in milliseconds. We make all the process, and when we finish, we see what is the difference between the present time and when it started. To the total time, we discount the difference we just calculated. This is the time we have to sleep. If the time, sleeping time is more than is zero, we sleep. If not, this means that we took more time than the frame we asked for more than 100 milliseconds. Anyway, we send a small sleep of 10 ms so that our application doesn't need a lot of CPU, and in this way, it leaves CPU for other applications. Okay, let's run it. And if you watch carefully now, you can see that there is no increase or decrease in the speed. The last thing would be to finish this small tutorial to manage the speed variable in the view. Let's add a speed field. And let's make it bounce against the borders. Instead of this simple, if okay, the only thing I did here is add a speed field initialized with a 1, which is the increment that we're going to do. This means that when it gets to the right border, this border is the length of the screen minus the length of the BMP. If it gets to that value, it goes in the other direction, and if it gets to 0, it goes back in the other direction. Here we have the increment. Instead of a constant, we have this variable, and everything else the same. Let's see if it works. Don't worry, this was a cut I made so that you don't have to wait, and as you see, here it bounces in the right border. And after this other cut, we can see how it gets to the left border and bounces back. Okay, with this we finish the tutorial number 3 of Android game programming. See you in the next one.